Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Today I will talk about something related to the discussion about Palestine. Who does it belong to? There are certain issues really brought up this this topic to be discussed, one of which is someone sent me a post about a person, Avi Lipkin. He wrote a book called Return to Mecca. He says that the Torah is not limiting the borders of the land to Palestine, but rather it extends to Arabian Peninsula. And also, unfortunately, after signing the agreement between United Arab Emirates and Bahrain on one side and Israel on the other side, some people from among Arabs and Muslims, and even some of them Palestinians in origin, they started promoting what they say that it is peace, although it will just extend the duration of the conflict, because it's not addressing the very roots of the problem. The problem is not, as President Trump says, Arab-Israeli conflict, because he said soon it will be end. How about the very question of Palestine? You know, if all Arab nations signed an agreement with Israel, doesn't give Israel legitimacy, because they are not addressing the question which is the source for the problem, the question of Palestine. What are you going to do with Palestine? What are you going to do with people who were expelled from their homes and their lands were stolen and taken by force, occupied? What's your solution for this? Ignoring this means that we are extending the duration of the problem, of the conflict, and it means more blood will be shed before reaching to a solution. So a person also asked me about an ayah in Al-Quran Al-Kareem, in Surah Al-Ma'idah, in which it says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told the children, said about Musa, when Musa told the Israelites, يا قوم ادخلوا الأرض المقدسة التي كتب الله لكم ولا ترتدوا على أدباركم فتنقلبوا خاسرين. And Musa said to his people, my people, remember God's blessings on you, how he raised prophets, you know, among you and appointed kings for you and gave you what he had not given to any other people. My people, go into the holy land which God has ordained for you. Don't turn back or you will be the losers. Enter the land that God ordained for you. Some people will say, here it is, God ordained it for us. So if I want to focus the discussion on the meaning of the ayah, if the other side does not believe in the ayah, it means, you know, nothing. So I figured out that the best thing is to go first, before addressing the meaning of the ayah, to the Old Testament, to the Torah. What did the Torah say about Abraham, or about Abraham, or about Ibrahim when he entered into Palestine? And what did the Torah say about Musa, Moses alayhi salam, when he asked his people to enter into the Holy Land? And what did people answer? And what did God tell them? And what happened? From the Torah. The first thing, let's start with Ibrahim. Ibrahim was not initially in Palestine. We know he lived the north of Iraq. And the book of Genesis, chapter 21, says that, and Abraham or Abram moved to Palestine and lived as foreigner. In Arabic, it says, وَتَغَرَّبَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ فِي أَرْضِ فِلَسْطِينَ أَيَّامًا كَثِيرًا. تغرب, he lived there as a foreigner from there, his homeland, which was in the north of Iraq. Now, different translations now are using different words. Some people said lived, but other translation used foreigner, other translation used alien, another translation used sojourner in Philistine County. So there was a country, there was a county or territory called Palestine. And Ibrahim lived there as foreigner. And you know, after that, Yaqub alayhi salam moved to Egypt. We know this after what happened to Yusuf alayhi salam. And then the book of Genesis also talks about Jacob. وَسَكَنَ يَعْقُوبُ فِي أَرْضِ غُرْبَةِ أَبِيهِ فِي أَرْضِ كَنْعَانِ. And Jacob settled again in the land of Canaan where his father had lived as foreigner. Genesis 37:1. Now, some people say God promised Abraham the land. Yes, let's look at the Genesis itself. What does it say? God promised Abraham the land for him and his offspring. And this is in Genesis 15:13. And mentions some nations that should be removed away from the land. All of them were idolaters. So he told them, all of the land you see, I will give to you and your offsprings forever. Your offsprings. Who are the offsprings? Ibrahim, we know, had two children, Ishmael first and Jacob. Both of them are his children. And there is actually a chapter in the Torah, it says Hajar and Ishmael. So actually Genesis chapter 16. So Ishmael was his first son. He is from among his offsprings. Not only this. As we'll see, what did the commentators talk about these ayat, these verses of the Torah? Now, in the days of Musa, let's move to Musa alayhi salam. Musa, as we know, he was sent and saved Israelites from Pharaoh in Egypt. He took them to Sinai. And then he, after that, asked them to enter into the Holy Land. And this is mentioned in the Quran too. So there is no discrepancy between both. They refused. Also, there is no discrepancy between both. Both Quran and the Torah, they say this. Till now, they agreed. And this is mentioned in Torah, specifically in the book of Numbers, Kitab al-A'dad. And it gives so many details about this. Did Musa alayhi salam ask some people to go and gather some news, and they returned to him, and we went unto the land to which you sent us, and it does flow with milk and honey. Here is its fruit, because they brought with him some fruit. But the people, they said, who lived there are powerful. And the cities are fortified and very large. We even saw the descendants of Anak there. The Amalekites, the giants, lived there in the Negev desert. The Hittites, the Jebusites, the Amorites lived in the hill of the country. And the Canaanites lived near the sea and along the Jordan, the river of Jordan. This is in book of Numbers. So they reported all of this to Musa, and at the end they refused to enter. So God told Musa, according to book of Numbers, it's mentioned in many chapters, chapter 13 and chapter 14, for those who would like to check. It says, but they refused to enter the land and said, and your children will be like the shepherds wandering in the wilderness for 40 years. In this way, they will pay for your faithfulness until the last of you lies dead in the wilderness. This is what the Old Testament says. So they refused, and they went for 40 years until they died. And this is mentioned in the Quran, as we said in Surah Al-Ma'idah, Surah number 5. Now after that, after the death of Musa alayhi salam, it's even mentioned in Quran, also in Surah Al-Baqarah, that they entered. But they entered after even arguing with their prophet, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told them, you have to go and fight under the leadership of Goliath, Talut. And then after that, Goliath was killed, alhamdulillah. And few of them entered. Few from among them obeyed the order and entered into the land under the leadership of Talut, and later on even Dawood, David came. So, but what does it mean? Does the order or the promise which is given to Abraham or to Moses, does it mean to expel people, all people? I read a commentary by Egyptian Coptic priest. His name is Antonius Fikri. He is a commentator in the Holy Book in Arabic. He is hegumen, a certain rank in the Coptic clergy, Qums, and his name is Antonius Fikri. He said, the ayah which talks about Abraham to expel people, it says to expel the idolaters. And just those people in that at that time, it doesn't give them, the Israelites, the permission to expel the Palestinians, the Iraqis, the Syrians, at all. Because they are not idolaters. And they are not living at that time. And furthermore, he said about the promise that you will take it all the way from the great river to the Euphrates. He said this promise was already fulfilled. And he brought up about from the book of Kings, chapter 4, 21. And it says, and Solomon, Sulaiman alayhi salam, ruled from the land of the Philistines as far as the border of Egypt. These countries brought tribute and were Solomon's subjects all of his life. Book of Kings 4:21. So you cannot use this to justify oppressing people nowadays. A person would say, well, this commentator is an Arab. Yes, he is an Arab, but he is also Coptic, very faithful to his faith. He's not a Muslim. I'm not quoting Muslims. When I talk about the ayah, I will quote Muslims. But when I want to talk about the Old Testament, I will quote commentators authorized to write commentary on that. And this priest is authorized by the Coptic Church. Now, Quran talks about this in Surah Al-Ma'idah from Ayah 21 to 26. So it says that Musa alayhi salam ordered people to go there. They refused. They will not enter. Go and fight with your Lord who are waiting for you. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قَالَ إِنَّهَا مُحَرَّمَةٌ عَلَيْهِمْ أَرْبَعِينَ سَنَةً يَتِيهُونَ فِي الْأَرْضِ. This land will be forbidden or is forbidden to them for 40 years. They will wander the earth. فَلَا تَأْسَ عَلَى الْقَوْمِ الْفَاسِقِينَ. Don't grieve over those who disobeyed. This is what the ayah says. Now, the key word in the ayah, the original ayah, التي كتب الله لكم, the key word كتب, does it mean ordained? Does it mean give? كتب لكم, Al-Qurtubi says it means you are had been ordered to enter. كتب بمعنى فرض or ordained. You are instructed to enter. And they refused. Not just Al-Qurtubi. Abu Hayyan, very well-known commentator, has a great book in Tafsir, Al-Bahru Al-Muhit. He said that if the ayah كتب لكم can mean both meanings. He said, let's investigate the first meaning that God gave to you. He said, but if we say that this is what is meant by the ayah, if God gave it to them, then how can it be forbidden for them later on? إِنَّهَا مُحَرَّمَةٌ عَلَيْهِمْ. The land is forbidden for them. It doesn't match. In one ayah, it says, it is for you. In another ayah, it is forbidden. That's it. So he says, most likely, the ayah means they were ordered to enter, they refused, then they got punished for 4 years. It's not that they were granted this, they didn't want to take it, so they were punished for refusing to take this grant or this gift. So the ayah doesn't mean what some Zionist Arabs are trying to sell for people at all. And the texts of the Torah doesn't justify what is happening now. What's happening now is that Zionist organizations are getting into that area for political reasons. The conflict there is political. The Crusaders, when they came, they attacked the region for political and economic reasons. Evidence for that, when they passed by in their way to the Middle East, they started fighting the Orthodox Christian, because Europe was Catholic and the Orthodox are viewed by them as heretics. They took over Hagia Sophia and they murdered people before they got into the Middle East. So they want them to control the Middle East for political reasons, for economic reasons. And Herzl, when he started his project, the Zionist project, he was offered Uganda to have the homeland there. And he accepted that. Only some other leaders did not agree with him, and that's it was said that he died in a state of depression at his late lifetime. And when Herzl actually wanted to have his first Zionist conference, he wanted to have it in Vienna. The rabbis in Vienna refused to do so. And they sent two delegates to Palestine to check the land. And they told them that because the saying was, okay, go ahead. We want, there is a land with no people. Let's give it to people who have no land. A land that has no people should be given to people who have no land. So the two rabbis from Vienna went to Palestine to check if there are people or not. So they sent their letter to the rabbis in Vienna. They said the bride is beautiful, but she is married to another man. Very much similar to the report that people reported to Musa alayhi salam. They told him it's Ardul Daban wal Asal, the land of honey and milk. And here is the fruit. And it has people. So the conflict is political, using religion to mobilize people. Some people are mobilized only based on theological motive. Some people are mobilized for political motive or for national identity. But let's not give this conflict a religious cover. For Muslims, you know, we believe in what Musa alayhi salam told people when he was in Egypt. When he was in Egypt and he was attacked by Pharaoh, and he was for some period before he took the Israelites with him to leave Egypt, there was some clash between the Pharaoh's forces and between the Israelites. And Musa told his people, قال موسى لقومه, what did he tell them? استعينوا بالله. And Musa told his people, seek Allah's help. واصبروا, and be patient. إن الأرض لله, indeed the earth belongs to Allah. يورثها من يشاء من عباده. He will grant it to whoever he chooses of his servants. والعاقبة للمتقين. And the best outcome belongs to the righteous. This is a universal rule. Sunnatullah Azza wa Jal. It will not be changed. الأرض لله يورثها من يشاء والعاقبة للمتقين. After the message of Musa, when people actually refused his orders, after that, Jesus alayhi salam was sent, and then Muhammad sallallahu alayhi salam was sent as the last and the final messenger. Now you have the message of Islam. Inna akramakum inda Allahi atqakum. The most righteous is the one who obeys Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala most. So you can no longer keep quoting the Torah, because now the authority belongs to the last revelation, to the Quran. And Quran didn't say the land belongs to the Palestinians per se. It says Al-Ardu Lillah, the land, the earth belongs to Allah. He'll give it whoever he wants, and the good result will be for the muttaqeen. So if the Palestinians are from among the muttaqeen, they deserve it. If Muslims are from the muttaqeen, they deserve it. If Muslims turned away, turn their backs to Islam and to the Book of God, and they tend to be like any other people in the world, there is no difference between them and between others. So they can no longer claim ownership in the land. So the land there has no guaranteed license to be given to the Israelites, because of what we mentioned, even according to the book, which it says it's given to them and to Abraham and his offsprings, and they were ordered to enter there, and they refused. But later on, after the death of Musa alayhi salam, they entered there, and the kingdom was realized in the days of Suleiman, according to the book of the Kings 4:21. So you cannot keep bringing the Torah to justify occupying people and oppressing people. And this is what some actually Israeli historians started realizing. And I'm mentioning some names. Avi Shalom, he wrote The Iron Wall. Ilyan Pepe, he wrote The Ethnic Cleansing of Palestinians. Michael Pellid, the general's son. He is a son of Israeli general, and he was in the army. And at a turning point, he changed his entire thinking. An incident happened where I think one niece got killed, unfortunately, by an operation carried by Palestinian guerrillas. So he said, when she was killed, I started thinking, what caused that person to go and kill? So he said, I started studying the conflict from its roots. And he wrote all of this in his book, The General's Son. And he said in one interview that whenever you call that piece of land, when you call it Israel, you are contributing to the torture and to the suffering of people. This land is Palestine. It must be kept as such. And we saw that even the Old Testament called it Art of Palestinian, the land of Palestine. So, and then you have some other even Jewish organizations, non-Zionist organizations. They have totally different view regarding this conflict. So I hope, inshallah Rabbil Alameen, that people will read history very well and will learn from the history. One lesson we need to learn from the history of that region is, and even the world, occupation will not last. Sooner or later, the occupation will end. The Crusaders came and occupied the land for over 100 years, and it ended. France occupied Algeria for over 130 years, and it ended. And the Mongols and the Tatar came and occupied the land, the same thing, and it ended. Occupation does not last. This is the lesson which we need to learn. Otherwise, we are extending the period of the conflict. And if we want to save the blood, we need to learn from this history very well. Inshallah Rabbil Alameen. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.